RV now for, I don't know, probably coming up 18 months, 2 years. So we are going to have a look and see if the air conditioning vents need cleaning. They probably do. They've never been cleaned. So we're going to take them off and have a look. So I've enlisted my friend Philip to take these off. But let's just have a look. Let's just have a look and see what we get. Okay, you can see the actual, that's meant to be black all the way along. And, okay, but look at this. My God. That is mould. That's fungus and mould. So, you really need to have a look at this. So, we're going to rinse this in water. No soap, just water. And we're going to clean these with some bleach in some soapy water. Just have a look of how dirty that water is and the dirt and muck. That's one filter. That's just one filter. So I think we've got a job here on our hands. It's not a big job. It takes a couple of minutes to take one out. It takes a couple of minutes to wash them. So probably 5 minutes per vent. Some vents have filters. They're the vents that suck air in, and the vents that blow the air out after it's been cooled, they don't have a filter at all, but it would be worth taking the vents out and just giving them a quick wipe or brush in some sort of mild bleachy water. So here's the finished. This is what it looks like when it's clean. You can see all the way through it. There's no dirt on it at all. So a couple of minutes to do the job, and well worth it.
It's been a great trip so far. We've had a lovely time in Florida and South Carolina. Very busy. Lots of sightseeing, doing lots of stuff. So we wanted to just rest up for a bit and catch up with a few jobs around the RV and catch up with a bit of paperwork, work on the computer, Glenn's editing and stuff. So one job that's been bugging me particularly for quite a while is the pictures in the RV, which are very beautiful, lovely frames, and they work perfectly in here to go with the decor. The only trouble is they're obviously just standard photographs in the frames, and what we would like to do is put our own photographs in there. Lord knows we've taken enough of them over the last few months. The other annoying thing is this picture has actually moved while we've been travelling, so it's even more irritating at the moment. So we thought we'd show you how to do it, because they do feel very solidly fixed to the wall, and we really didn't have any idea how we'd get it off to change the picture. Anyway, as it transpires, they're actually velcroed to the wall. It's actually held in three places with velcro. 1, 2, 3. And then a hook at the top. Very, very firmly fits to the wall, which is good. So the best way to get the velcro, to get in between the pieces of velcro, is with a flat knife. Or a flat piece of metal, and just very carefully so you don't damage the wallpaper, put the knife down the strip of velcro separating the two pieces. Okay, and when it's free, very carefully, if you stick that piece of card over the velcro, then when you come to take the other off, which have already been done earlier, they won't stick back on. Okay, so you've got the picture off the wall, and then we need to get the existing picture out of the frame in order to put our new one in. It's held in with lots of staples, all around the edge, and it's actually sealed as well. I guess that's to do with not letting any moisture get in into the picture and make the whole thing damp. So obviously that has to come off. I've got a little flathead screwdriver here, which pulls that out quite nicely. Try not to rip the backing, because I'm going to reuse that to go back over the picture. And then we've got to get all these little staples out. So just lift them slightly with your flathead screwdriver all the way along, like that. and then with a pair of very pointy pliers. I don't know if these things are also called the same thing in America.
Long-nosed pliers.
And you just take them out, and the, believe it or not, they're about half an inch long, which is a bit ridiculous because the frame part that it's going into is probably about an eighth of an inch deep. But anyway, take all of those out. We're actually going to use a different method of putting this back in. We're going to tape it. These staples are a bit of a pain.
Yeah.
And we need to take this out, which is all stuck together. The actual picture is stuck with glue at the very top, so you need to prise that off at the top, but without bending this this frame, this, they call it a cadre in France, what do they call it here? This part of the frame, the surround. So just get the knife again and just gently loosen that bit of self-adhesive tape, I think it is double-sided tape or something. So we have our new photograph to go in the picture. It's one that we took at Canyonlands, I think. And it's nice and colourful, instead of the black and white, so it will cheer the place up a bit. And we're just going to slot that in. It's on a piece of paper that's obviously bigger than the frame at the moment. So I'm going to slot it under the surround just to make sure it fits, and then I'm just going to cut it at the bottom. So I'm just going to cut it about there, and then I'm actually going to put some double-sided tape here which will hold that in place, and it will stop it falling either one way or the other. So because these staples were half an inch thick and at an angle, and we haven't got a staple gun, we are going to tape the back, which is a sort of old-fashioned way of putting a picture frame together. So to hold this back section into the frame. So in order not to cover our Velcro up, I'm just cutting strips of a very strong tape and putting it directly onto the white backing. Pressing it firmly down there, and then of course it has to be recessed into the space that's available for it, and then just press the tape down alongside, so it's actually going into that corner, the tape. I'm doing it in sections, then I'll put a piece across the corner as well. So we're very happy with the way this looks. We've given the Perspex a good clean with windowing inside and out. And now we're going to put it on the wall. So we're going to hang it on the hook and take the bottom Velcro out first to position it and just make sure it's level. And then we're going to take the other two out. So the important thing is to line the hook up. A two-man job, so Glenn, you're going to have to help me here. That's on?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. So it's still floating now.
So just hold it away from the wall with your finger.
And then holding it away with your third hand. Just check the measurement.
from the sidewall. 7.5. That looks straight. To you, Glenn?
Yep. Just lightly fix it at the bottom.
I'll lightly fix it and then take it again. 7.5. 7.5. So we'll take the side cards off now very carefully so that you don't take the wallpaper off with them. And then fix it all the way around where you know the Velcro is. Very firmly, you can hear it squashing together. This is what it looked like before, and this is what it looks like now. Bit of an improvement, do you think? I love it. And it's a real good memory and souvenir. One of the places, one of the many places we've been to on one of our trips. And to celebrate, obviously, compulsory Vin and Donny. Chicken and stuff. Vodka and tonic.
I'm sure that bit's not wonky.
So today I'm going to try and install some of these LED lights, which you can buy on a strip. This particular light is waterproof, not that it needs to be where I'm going to install it. And this particular light changes colour. You can have, I think, 256 different colours. And this is the same light that we've actually put in our overhead on the central ceiling. And the difference it makes is quite incredible. So what the plan is today is basically to... The plan is to run a strip of lights around, just behind this pelmet, all the way around. So basically, when I put the LEDs on, it will give this cab area a very nice halo effect. Because what we found is in the evening when we're in the lounge, it's like the dark hole of Calcutta over here. It's like dark and gloomy. So I'm going to wire them up, I'm going to try them, and if they look, you know, bad, and we just won't use them, I don't think I'll take them down. The LEDs are actually self-adhesive, so you just peel off the backing. So it's a very straightforward job. But first of all, I just want to make sure that we've got a 12 volt supply. So over on this light, by the way, my 9-year old nephew is behind the camera. So thank you, JJ.
You're welcome.
So first thing to do is to make sure that I've got a 12 volt supply. So I've disconnected the map reading light. And I've got my 12 volt tester, and you can see that I've got 12 volts. So that 12 volt supply is going to be the supply for the LED lighting. And then all I need to do somewhere along the line is just put a LED controller in so I can change from blue to green to red to mauve to pink to yellow to whatever I want. So the first thing to do is that I've identified my 12 volt supply. I'm going to remove this panel because I'm going to lose the wire for the lighting inside this panel. And there's plenty of room on this panel. I've had this panel off several times. It would help if I took all the screws out. There's one I missed. So as you can see, a perfect example of Entegra's attention to detail. Disgraceful, really. I mean, it would take 5 or 10 minutes to actually pin those cables to the wall. So just like a spaghetti junction. So fault finding must be an absolute nightmare. So first thing I need to do, I've worked out where I'm going to drill the hole, but I need more space, so I'm going to pull the blinds down, actually.
Because one thing I got to be aware of is that I don't damage the blind, the shade, with the drill. So by moving the shade down, I've got more space. So very carefully, and on through already. It's obviously very thin wood. So I'm just gonna, so all I've got to do now is basically fish a wire through, join it to this, and once I've got the wires here, I can then stick the LED all the way around. So I'm gonna do that now. So I've managed to fish a wire through. It's a little bit tricky. No damage to the shade and no damage to the wood. I just, instead of the drill being all the way in, which would normally be the case, I basically extended the drill to the furthest point to give me a longer reach. So now I'm going to join my 12 volt cable to this. So okay, they will come on with the map reading lights temporarily until I can buy a controller, but that's no problem because I can put the map lights on and then turn off the individual lights, leaving just the LEDs. So all I've got to do now is, once I've got a 12 volt connection, I can then just go ahead and stick the LED all the way round, put it all back together, and it should work. And I think my wiring will be a lot neater than this wiring. Very important, as I do all the jobs I do, I always solder. Solder is the best possible connection you can use. So I've twisted the wires together. I'm now soldering them, and then I'll apply a little piece of heat shrink. If you have the wire facing down, any excess solder runs off the edge. Then you don't get a big blob of solder left. So I'll leave that a couple of seconds, and then I'm going to put some heat shrink on. Okay. You only need a little bit of heat, and then just crush the end over, and that will stop those wires coming into contact. So, with all that wiring done, I'm just putting this back together, but because the wiring's in such a mess behind it, it's a bit tricky sometimes because you get wires pulled. So the actual wiring into the map reading light, literally a 5-minute job. Really doesn't take long at all. Try and avoid using an electric screwdriver, because that's where half the problems on these coaches arise, is that they use electric screwdrivers for everything, and they over tighten the screws, so they actually lose grip. I will have to replace these screws because they're always loose. So okay, the next thing now is basically to hardwire the LED lights. Now I haven't got an LED controller at the moment, so I'm probably going to hardwire them for blue. I've got three options: blue, green, or red. The controller mixes those colours to get you the 256 colours, but for now I'm going to hardwire it for blue. And obviously Julia will come back and say that's wrong, it should be green. So whatever colour I choose, I know it's going to be the wrong colour, but I like blue, so I'm going to put, maybe I should have bought a blue coach. So I'm going to hardwire them for blue. So before we stick on the LEDs, get yourself some sort of cleaning agent. We're actually using a window cleaner, the spray window cleaner, because it evaporates really quick. And just make sure that it's nice and clean behind, or where you're going to stick the LEDs, because otherwise they won't stick. So I've just done this twice, and I'm pretty sure that's pretty clean now. So the next job is to actually stick on the LEDs. So this is self-adhesive, LEDs. And the great thing is, it just is so easy. Just try and keep them straight and taut. On the home run now.
Now, one thing you have to remember on LEDs, you can see this is too long. I could just return it on the inside, but with LEDs, there's sections all the way along that you can actually cut it without any damage. So I'm actually going to cut this here on the copper strip. These are actually the wrong cutters to do this with, but it will do the job. So now I'll carry on with the sticking. To access these points, it's really a good idea to bring the shade down, because as the shade comes down, the bulk of it, the roller, gets smaller and you'll get more room for your fingers. So I'll just bring that shade down. Okay. Okay, so now I can get my fingers in there and stick the last little bit. So this is what it looks like normally at this end of the coach in the evening. But now we can have a lovely halo effect in the front, which we can dim. We can change colour from blue to green to red to mauve to pink, any colour we want. And I think you'll agree, that's lovely. And it also, with the blinds all the way up, it also looks really good. So, a good job well done, didn't take long to do, and I think the total cost of the job was about $20.
So thanks for watching, enjoy your travels, stay safe on the road, and it's really nice bumping into so many people who recognise us and say hello, and we love it. Having a great time. Thanks.